Hi.
How are you?
Good, thank you.
Now,
Very good.
Vanessa, I'm a big fan of yours. I've been a big fan of yours for a while. You're one of my favourite journalists. You're one of the journalists that I go to for my news in Syria, from Syria and the Middle East, etc. And I searched you
Say
today.
Hi to the cat.
No, pussycat. I searched your name today to figure out how to spell your last name because I wasn't
right. Sure. Yeah.
I or Y. So just searched and in Google he auto-filled it and said blogger.
Oh, how nice.
Blogger.
Blogger.
Did it
put obscure blogger before the blogger bit?
I forgot what it was. What was it? It said something blogger. Was it obscure?
It might have been. I mean, that was, apart from being, what is it, the propaganda goddess, according to Brian Whittaker, who sold the gay girl of Damascus story early on. But like, we won't go into that.
Well, I find it funny that whenever there's a journalist who reports on war crimes that the Western world are doing around the world, especially in the Middle East, the first thing that the media do is try and say they're not a journalist. So I'm assuming that the next step for you, and hopefully this isn't the next step, is going to be Belmarsh prison next in the cell next to Julian Assange.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, I've been talking about this latest BBC salvo for the last few days. And of course, you know, it's a massive subject because, of course, the whole of the Syrian conflict has been it's such an information war between, as you say, the dissident journalists who are actually on the ground inside Syria and reporting testimony from Syrian civilians. That's basically what we're doing. You know, we're not making these stories up from the ether. We're actually transmitting the voices of the Syrian people that have been completely disappeared by Western media, who take the majority of their information and narratives from either the terrorist groups or from groups that are affiliated with the armed groups, i.e. the White Helmets and a number of other NGOs that have been infiltrated into Syria by British and American intelligence.
I want to obviously talk to you about all of this. You might be here a while. I hope you've got time. First of all, let's start. I mean, I haven't got anything planned. I've just literally got me interested, so I can chuck that down there now. The thing that interested me, like I say, there's somebody from the BBC who's reached out to you and Eva Bartlett. And they've reached out because there's going to be a Radio 4 series on the White Helmets and James Lemurier and Syria and the conflict in Syria. And they've reached out, and one of the accusations I remember seeing was that you're not classically trained as a journalist, or you're not trained as a journalist, to which I think, well, who is trained as a journalist? Because at the moment I can think of, right, okay, people like Paul Mason and James O'Brien and all these people who are getting Syria and the conflict in Syria wrong and retweeting Bellingcat like it's the gospel on the situation.
Oh yeah, Bellingcat.
They're the ones who are trained.
Bellingcat has all the qualifications he needs, of course, to examine scientific evidence for chemical weapon attacks. Oh, yep.
in his expose in the New York Times, we're talking about Bellingcat and what's his name. I won't even repeat his name. But he said that he got his experience from playing computer games and Call of Duty.
Allegedly.
And this is how we're meant to take these people seriously. What is your background, Vanessa? Where do you get this lust for telling the truth from?
As I've said many times, actually, probably from my father. My father was a British diplomat and ambassador to a number of countries in the Middle East. He was Middle East advisor.
Vanessa, can I just you're doing that thing with your top and it's scratching on the microphone. Yeah, you're scratching. So you're scratching on your thing, and I could just hear scratches on the microphone. Sorry.
Oh, sorry. Sorry. I'll try and hold it forward so it's not.
No, it was okay. You were scratching the
top. Yeah.
It's fine like that. If you just let it hang down, it'll be fine.
All there right. you go. I'll try not to move.
So it was from your father, you say? That's.
Yeah, I mean, you know, my father was Middle East advisor to Ernest Bevin, who of course was Foreign Secretary under Anthony Eden. Okay. And Bevan, of course, was strongly against the Zionist settlement in Palestine. And if you like, this was a very small window where Britain actually pushed back against the Truman Doctrine of settlement or Israeli settlement, illegal settlement on Palestinian territory.
Okay.
And then, of course, they were targeted by the Stern Gang, etc., by Israeli terrorist organizations. And it all sort of fell apart. And then, you know, we know the history. But my father, all his life, campaigned for the Palestinian cause and was involved in lecturing and talking about the truth on Palestine. So I kind of grew up in that environment. It didn't mean that I automatically went into the Foreign Service, or as Peter Ford says, I didn't become a Foreign Office brat. You know, I kind of took a very different path. I kind of deviated entirely from the path. And then when my dad died in 2001, I kind of picked up all his confidential papers. I started to go through them, and my curiosity was piqued. And then in 2012, I went to Egypt, and from there into Gaza, Palestine, where I met Eva Bartlett, actually, at the Rafah border crossing was our first meeting. She managed to get in. I was spun. I eventually went in through the tunnels just as one day later Israel started bombing in 2012.
So 2012 is like when you start, and this is like right at the beginning of what they call the Arab Spring, isn't it? What was the area you said you were going into? The Rafah, did you say? Raqqa?
Yeah, the Rafah crossing, which is the Egyptian side of the border with Gaza.
Okay.
So in other words, I crossed through Egypt. There was no chance on earth of getting in through the Zionist crossing on the other side of Gaza.
Yeah, because it's like it's sort of pinned, isn't it, between the sea and Egypt and you know, the state of Israel, and sort of that's the only way to get in and out, isn't it, through that, I suppose, that crossing from Israel, from Egypt rather.
Yeah, well, it's in theory an easier crossing. I didn't find it to be so. But it's still effectively controlled by the Zionist entity, even though it's on the Egyptian side.
Was 2012 the first time you'd been to Gaza?
Yeah. Not the first time I'd been to Egypt. Of course, I'd actually grown up in Egypt when my father was there as ambassador. That was my first trip to Palestine.
I've heard lots of stories about how bad it is in Gaza, and how calling it an open air prison, it doesn't do it justice, because open air prisons, I mean, you've still got heat and water all day long. Mm. How can you explain it to people who haven't been there, and how can you explain it? What we're seeing, is that like the tip of the iceberg, or is it
No, I mean, it's very hard.
You took a big, deep sigh then before you said that.
I mean, you know, you're talking an area of land the size of the Isle of Wight, let's say, to put it into perspective. In that area, you have now probably around 2 million people, the majority of whom are, I would say, between the ages of 18 to 25. The crowding in Gaza is unbelievable. It is literally a concentration camp. Everything is controlled by the Zionist entity. In other words, the water supply, the food supply, the electricity supply, the internet supply. You have to pay in shekels, which is the ultimate humiliation for these people. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when Israel decides to, as they euphemistically call it, mow the lawn, it's like shooting.
Oh, you're frozen again.
Fish in a barrel with no distance, you know, but they have nowhere to go.
Yeah.
It's an area which is completely overcrowded. They can't escape. They can't escape by the sea because, of course, there are the fishing limitations which are constantly being altered and reduced by the Zionist entity.
Yeah.
The sea itself is filthy. I can't remember the tonnage of sewage that Israel pours into the coast off Gaza. So effectively, everything is polluted, everything is contaminated. The water supply into Gaza is often contaminated or destroyed, of course, by the bombing campaigns. The 2014 bombing campaign was actually probably the worst I think Gaza has ever seen, and mm-hmm. and the decimation and destruction after that campaign is still not being addressed. It's still not being rebuilt, and you know, so the people are continuing to live in what is an open air concentration camp, in absolutely dreadful conditions. I mean, conditions you can't even imagine. I mean, if for example you go to any of the beach camps, the original sort of refugee camps, mm-hmm. Shati Beach Camp, for example, people are literally piled on top of one another in these ever increasing high rise apartments. With barely any electricity or water, very little sewage treatment. So when, for example, there's a heavy rainfall, the streets are literally flowing with sewage. And at any time, I mean, for example, every single day you will hear gunshots off the coast because the Zionist warboats are attacking the Gaza fishing boats.
Yeah.
One. The Israeli planes will fly fast and low to break the sonic barrier and to create the sonic boom, which of course further traumatize kids that are suffering with PTSD and are displaying all manner of kind of psychological trauma, which result in sort of ADHD symptoms, right? There are random drone attacks on someone that they will, that the Zionists will deem to be a member of Hamas or a member of the resistance. Yeah. You know, I was there one day in a meeting and there was a massive explosion literally right outside in the street, and a drone had targeted a hospital porter on his way to work on his motorbike. And they can just put out an announcement, yeah, but you know, he was with the resistance. Everyone in Gaza is with the resistance. So everyone is actually effectively a target.
This is the same as the Americans, isn't it? That, you know, that if you're a male and you're over 18, you're a terrorist, as far as I, at least in the statistics, even though actually when you look into the statistics, 9 out of every 10 person who gets killed in a drone strike is actually just an innocent person who was, you know, gets caught in what Sam Harris would call collateral damage, which I think is a disgusting term. So.
It is.
You obviously witnessed this in Gaza in 2012, 2013. From there, did your sort of reporting branch out into the wider area?
I mean, actually, interestingly, you know, I have tremendous faith in the actual Palestinian resistance. In my opinion, and it's a controversial opinion for many, Palestine is occupied three ways. It's occupied by the Zionist entity. Mm-hmm. It's occupied by its own leadership, Hamas mm-hmm. and Fatah. And it's occupied by what I call the NGO complex or the smart power complex, which increased dramatically from the Oslo agreement onwards to a point where now every single sector of Palestinian life is controlled by what are effectively, of course, Zionist and US backed NGOs, right, that control education, they control agriculture, they control health.
When they say NGOs, these are non-governmental organizations. So basically what they're doing is putting in companies that the governments are working hand in hand in, correct?
Yeah, and I would always argue the term vociferously NGO, because the majority of NGOs are government funded. I mean, as for example, the White Helmets in Syria, it cannot possibly in a million years call itself an NGO because it's funded by all the governments waging the war against Syria, right? My point is, I've forgotten what we were actually... When I was in Gaza in 2013 in April, there was a huge attack by Israel in Damascus. And at the time, people were wondering whether it was a tactical nuke attack because of the mushroom cloud that came up from the explosion. And I remember interviewing one of the leading spokespeople for Hamas, and he basically, I mean, my jaw just dropped at that point, because he told me, yeah, but it's understandable, you know, Damascus was supplying weapons to Hezbollah. And, okay. You know, I mean, my kind of illusion had been that Hezbollah and Iran and Syria were basically the main supporters of Hamas. Hamas had taken up residence in Damascus for a while before mm-hmm. they moved to Doha. And that kind of set me thinking about what was going on in Syria and the fact that things were not quite all that they seemed. And so then I started to sort of unravel it, to speak to people. I spoke to Eva Bartlett. She had founded the Syria Solidarity Movement at that point. So I joined that. And then we all started kind of talking about what was going on and researching. I then had to come back to France for medical reasons. I actually was diagnosed with cancer in Gaza. I had to come back to France for treatment. And so that kind of kept me housebound for about, I'm fine.
Okay. I'm going to say you should be wearing a cape with a big S on it, you know?
Oh no, God, no. I mean, everyone, you know, most people I know have gone through some degree of illness or whatever, you know, it's just part of your journey. It's just part of who you are. That's how I look at it.
If you were a celebrity, you'd be on Twitter and you'd be milking it right now. But you know.
Well, I don't know. I don't see the point. I mean, you know, it was actually, how can I put it? It was actually a relatively pain-free treatment. I mean, I had surgery and I refused chemo and I did a fair amount of alternative treatments.
Okay.
And I'm fine.
Okay.
So, and then basically to fast forward, then I tried to get a visa to go to Syria in 2014-15. Just, you know, all these people that say were given visas by the Syrian government and were facilitated. No.
Didn't quite happen like that. You were refused to make the turn and you had to jump through a lot of hoops.
I mean, it took me 2 years processing and eventually I entered in 2016. With an American peace delegation. I was the only Brit on the peace delegation, which was quite amusing. Everyone kept assuming I was American.
Okay.
And during that trip, we had a 2-hour interview with President Assad. But we also met members of the opposition. We met faith leaders. We met civil society organizations and, you know, their directors. We went to orphanages. We were taken on a huge, yes, you know, it was a Syrian government facilitated tour, but there was no control other than necessary security because we're in a war zone.
I remember they smeared Tulsi Gabbard with the same brush when she went to Syria and met with Assad, and they said, oh, she's an Assad apologist, and there was the great Barry Weiss who said that she was an Assad toady and then didn't know what toady meant, which I thought was brilliant. But they smeared her with the same thing. They said she met with Assad, but she says, no, I met with all the opposition as well, and we went, you know, it was a whole thing that we went on. And obviously this is something, I mean, I can imagine that if you're going into a place like Syria that has been ripped apart by what they call a civil war for 8 years, which I'm extremely dubious as to whether there's anything civil about that war at all. But, you know, it's only natural that you're going to have some sort of protection. To, you know, it's going to have to be sort of arranged, isn't it, for you to get, okay, you're going to go meet this and this to try and get a bigger picture. And obviously I imagine that your eyes are always looking for the wool being pulled over them, being a journalist, and your spidey senses will tingle if ever.
Exactly. And I think, you know, the hypocrisy of, for example, the BBC producer saying that, you know, I enter Syria, I'm given a visa by the Syrian government, and we're taken on whatever it was, organized tours. Well, hello, you know, for example, when I went to Douma, yeah, I was on an organized tour, but I was on an organized tour with ITV. No, but with ITV and CNN. Hold on, why don't you talk to ITV and CNN, who came with me, and a number of German media outlets. And the reason you go on an organized tour, as she calls it, I can't remember what she called it, is because you're entering a recently liberated area. There's potential for mines. There's potential for booby traps. There's potential for sleeping cells, as the OPCW investigators found out when they tried to enter the first time they were shot at.
Yeah.
So of course we go in a bus with the army. The army meet us there and they escort us because we're at risk at that point.
No, you're meant to just turn up there and go up to the terrorists with a badge on your thing that says press and expect them not to chop your head off. That's what you're meant to do.
I know. I mean, it's so ridiculous, these accusations. And the thing is that they're so boring now. Look, we've had this for 4 years.
Yeah.
Come on, BBC. After 4 years of us being vindicated, of our reporting actually being vindicated. I mean, I was, you know, one of the first journalists on the ground in Douma saying it was a staged event, mm-hmm. as was Robert Fisk.
Yeah.
You know, and a number of other journalists. We're vindicated okay. by the experts in the OPCW team.
So for people who are listening to this as a standalone video, what happened in Douma was it 2017, February, March?
2018.
There was allegedly a chemical weapons attack by the Assad government on what they called the moderate rebels in Douma who were losing the war. And apparently Assad did this right at the point where he was going to win the war and get everything that he needed, making sure that the powers that are much more powerful than him came down and crushed his attempt at winning the war. Now, I called bullshit on it immediately. There is absolutely, it makes, the one thing that you cannot allege against Assad is that he's stupid. And he's not stupid. This is somebody who went to school in the UK. Correct? He went to school. Yeah. We educated him. He's met the Queen, for Christ's sake. So it made no sense that he would have launched this chemical attack right at the point where the only people who would benefit from this chemical attack in Douma at that time were these so-called moderate rebels. And I say so-called moderate rebels because then there's nothing moderate about them, and they're not rebels either. What they are is terrorists that we are arming and funding. That's the allegation I'm making. What do you think, Vanessa? Am I closer to the truth than the BBC?
Yeah, quite a bit closer to the truth than the BBC. And the recent leak of UK Foreign Office documents that were leaked by the same anonymous organisation that leaked the Integrity Initiative documents, they've been verified, these documents, by the way, because Dominic Raab put out a statement saying, yeah, but everyone knew we were running intelligence operations in Syria. But by the way, Russia hacked our website and stole the documents. We're supposed to ignore the fact that the UK government has effectively been violating international law for 10 years, and even prior to 2011, they were planning this violation of international law, mm-hmm. Because the Russians did it again. You know, they conducted cyber warfare against our government and stole the documents from them.
So this chemical weapons attack, what they're alleging is, now we remember Theresa May, which stood up in the House of Commons and said, using open source information, in other words,
White
information
helmet.
That she was getting from the White Helmets and Bellingcat. And for me at the time, I mean, this is going back to my early days on this, and I had already seen enough evidence to say that these White Helmets were not who that they were being portrayed to be in the media and in the cinema, because this is a group that won an Oscar. I don't know whether this organization was set up with good intentions and then went bad, or whether it was set up to do what it's gone on to do. I suspect I know which is the case, but it was set up by a group outside Syria, funded by us, headed by an ex-spy, MI5's or MI6's James Le Mesurier. And he set up this, it's called the Syria Civil Defense, isn't it? Explain why that is, Vanessa. to give the illusion that it's anything to do with Syria, isn't it?
Yeah, and I mean, that's a very important point to make. I mean, effectively from the beginning, no, there was no good intention behind creating this group. James Lemessurier, the founder, as you said, in 2013 in Turkey and Jordan, had a history of remodeling Al-Qaeda. I mean, he'd worked on the transformation of the KLA, the Kosovo Liberation Army, which was effectively comprised of Al-Qaeda and Albanian mafia warlords, both of whom were guilty of cross-border organ trafficking, while James Lemessurier was in the process of transforming and whitewashing them into the Kosovo Security Corps under the direction of Bernard Kouchner, who was the then UN representative in Pristina in 1999. So fast forward to Syria, and at the time that we know from the leaked documents, although we already knew from documents that I'd found, for example, in the East Aleppo Nusra Front headquarters, that the British government was involved in the funding of groups that were both working with the terrorist groups, which of course are Al-Qaeda dominated, and producing the propaganda to corroborate UK foreign policy in Syria, which of course is the removal of the Syrian government. Now that's been corroborated by a UK policy document, which I think was published in April 2017. And it actually states in that document that that is the role of the White Helmets to and this is the wording of the document, to provide evidence to corroborate the case against the Syrian government and the Russian allies, right?
So they're funding and doing the exact same thing that they are accusing you of.
Yeah, basically. And I don't get any funding. But and in that document, it's also stated, of course, that Amnesty International and Human Rights Watch also rely heavily, if not almost entirely, on the White Helmets to produce the evidence for their reports. So what you have here is, as John Pilger called it, a propaganda construct that was established.
Create their own news.
And, you know, if you look at the reason we went into Iraq, which again was defended by the BBC, was of course the dodgy dossier on the weapons of mass destruction. What the White Helmets have been tasked with fabricating or with staging are the chemical weapon attacks, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. And so forward again to Duma, let's ignore the questions and the discrediting of the Ghouta attack in 2013 and the 2017 Khan Shehun attack. We'll ignore the discrediting of that by people like the UN weapons inspector, Scott Ritter and Seymour Hersh and a number of other very, very acclaimed and eminent researchers, analysts, scientists and journalists. But if we come forward to the Duma attack in 2018, you've put it into context. Many of us claimed publicly, myself because I was on the ground, that it was a staged event. I spoke to medical staff, doctors, nurses that were there on the night of the attack. They told me it was staged. They told me that the White Helmets created panic by shouting chemical attack and by hosing down kids and giving them Ventolin when, you know, they didn't really need it, etc. And then, you know, you went through Russia presenting witnesses to The Hague, the kid Hassan Diab, who was in the actual footage that the White Helmets disseminated to the media. Fast forward a bit more, you have Riam Dalati, who's a BBC producer, actually stating publicly that the event was staged, and he had evidence to that effect. One question to the BBC, why has Riam Dalati and the BBC not given that evidence to the OPCW for their investigation?
As soon as people like me collared onto that and started going to Twitter and asking more questions, he immediately made his Twitter account private.
Yeah, he disappeared, basically. He was brought home back to base, I think, at that point. We have to remember that Riam Dalati was on the production team of Panorama's Saving Syria Children in 2013, which has been, you know, exposed as a staged event by researcher Robert Stewart.
I watched it once. I watched that. This is meant to be the They're meant to be people who are suffering the after effects of chemical weapons. All you've got to do is just turn the sound off and watch that without the sound. And you can see these are actors acting. This is not people.
It's a bit like the Michael Jackson Thriller video, isn't it?
It really is. It's just, it's pathetic. And you can't find that anywhere now, can you? Usually the BBC, yeah, no problem. It's on the iPlayer. You cannot find it anywhere. They won't even put it on YouTube, will they?
Of course, Robert has downloaded everything forensically and has it all archived. So, you know, this is going to haunt them for history. But back to Duma. And you then had the coming forward of the experts who were part of the OPCW investigative teams, who came forward and effectively said the final report is fraudulent because it has suppressed evidence that we gave. It has suppressed our research and analysis, and we demand a hearing. Mm-hmm. And so this was, you know, I mean, this is an extraordinary scandal, real time.
Yeah, it doesn't stop there, Vanessa. I mean, you've run through the highlights there as quick as possible. I mean, you'll know I interviewed your colleague at the working group of Syria and the media, Piers Robinson, in January, I think it was. And I remember going through with him, and, you know, these are meant to be people who have died from a chlorine attack. Now, chlorine attack kills roughly, I mean, there's been lots of chlorine attacks, so we've got lots of statistics and data on this. Chlorine attacks usually kill about 1 in 20 people. According to this attack on Duma, it killed everybody, 100%. There were no signs of anybody running away. It was, I mean, it's clear that these people have been killed by something and then placed there, isn't it? I mean,
Yeah, and this is the question that the BBC has not asked. Who killed those civilians?
No, they just keep saying, oh, so Assad's never done a chemical weapons attack, isn't it? It's like, no, that's not the question. The question is, did he do this one?
Look, at the end of the day, if you look at the kind of the cura bono, who benefits from these narratives, these chemical weapon narratives, certainly not President Assad, certainly not Russia, who, by the way, is in charge of making sure that Syria doesn't use chemical weapons, right? Those who benefit are the US coalition and the armed groups, because they know that they can halt an advance of the Syrian Arab army simply by calling chemical attack.
I would say the people who are going to benefit from that are what Julian Assange would call the regrettable elements within the West.
Yeah, exactly. Because
obviously, you know, people aren't all bad, but there are some who are awful. And these are the people, it seems, that are running these operations.
Yeah. So, you know, you have a situation where you have to start asking the questions. If the OPCW is prepared to produce a fraudulent report in order to justify the unlawful aggression of the UK, US and France after the Duma chemical attacks, alleged chemical attacks, then you have to start questioning its previous investigations into Khan Shehun, which of course led to President Trump launching, I can't remember how many, 50 odd cruise missiles into Syria. And then Ghouta, and of course the Ghouta chemical attack, if we look at the context of that, there had actually been a chemical attack by the armed groups, by the terrorist groups, against civilians, Syrian civilians and Syrian army in March of 2013 in Khan al-Asl, which is close to Aleppo. It took the UN 6 months to organize a team to come and investigate that crime. And at the day they arrived in Damascus, that's convenient. There's a chemical attack allegedly by the Syrian government.
He knows they're going to be there. He knows the OPCW are going to be there at that time on that day. So why would he do it then?
Well, as Elliot Higgins said to me at one point, he said, because they're all dumb as bricks. That's his conspiracy theorist argument.
It's like saying at the moment that, you know, Donald Trump, or the last few years, Donald Trump is Vladimir Putin's puppet, and really the people who are running our country are Russia, and he's a threat to our national security. It's like, okay, fine. If that's your where you stand, why have you just given him $700 billion for war? Why have you done that then? And it was the Democrats that said, yes, no problem, and ticked it. Yes, he's Vladimir Putin's puppet. Let's give him another 100 billion for some more rockets. That makes no sense whatsoever, does it?
To be honest, in all honesty, nothing makes any sense. And until you actually start to engage your rational brain and stop listening to Western media, whoever it is, CNN, Sky News, BBC, The Guardian, Channel 4. Channel 4 have been one of the worst of simply running. I mean, I've had run-ins with Channel 4. Was it, oh, God, what's the... Just forgotten his name. The Irish journalist.
Oh, I don't know. The only one I know is Alex Thompson.
Oh, I've had run-ins with him as well. But anyway, this... it'll come to me. But this guy, there was a point where I was actually in East Aleppo. Channel 4 had run an Al Jazeera video. And of course, Al Jazeera are well known for falsifying videos. Mm-hmm. If people want to have a look at a film I made with a Syrian documentary maker, and the film's called The Veto. It's on my YouTube channel, and it's about an hour and 10 minutes of falsifying media reports, basically, from the very beginning of the conflict. And Channel 4 are involved in it. And I remember having this conversation with this Channel 4 reporter, and they'd put out this Jazeera report without any editing at all, claiming that the Syrian government had bombed a premature baby unit in East Aleppo. And in the footage, which, as you said, has now strangely disappeared, I have it downloaded. You see the nurse in the midst of all this smoke go into the premature baby unit, pick the so-called premature baby up like a rugby ball and basically carry it around like this, like showing it to the film completely. Either it's a doll or it's in rigor mortis because it died an awful long time ago, right? Sadly. So she's holding it like this. She walks out of the room, cut to the next scene where she gives a live, much bigger baby to the nurse to hold to camera. And I remember saying to this Channel 4 journalist, are you serious? Ask your, if you have children, ask your wife to look at this footage, right? And then he started to get a bit shirty with me, and he started to say, are you trying to tell me that, you know, they falsified these as if, you know? And I said, well, as if incubator babies, Kuwait, as if weapons of mass destruction. I mean, no, you know, we've never done things like that before. And oddly, when I next looked at the Channel 4 report, they'd taken out that section of the rugby ball baby, but kept the rest of the report. Right, so clearly they admitted that that looks a bit dodgy actually.
Again, it's,
you know,
it's accusing your opposition of doing the very thing that you're guilty of, isn't it? You mentioned the Channel 4 there. I remember doing a video a while ago about when the families from Douma went to The Hague and testified that no, it wasn't a chemical weapons attack. Actually, what happened was we were in the tunnels and there was some shelling and the kids got hypoxia, just as people like yourself and Robert Fisk reported. And they were saying this, they were on the stage, and the Channel 4 guy, and this was in the news segment as well, I've actually got it on my computer somewhere, and he looked at the, and he said to the directors and to the people who brought them, have you got no shame? As if like you're lying through your teeth here. It's like, no, these are people were at Douma and they're saying that it wasn't a chemical weapons attack, and you're a reporter. What is going on here? If you're not reporting, you're just, you know, casting assertion. What is going on? Because you're not clearly not there to report and tell us the truth, are you? You're clearly part of a massive propaganda campaign. And this is what I see Syria as. They want regime change. And when I say they, it means those regrettable elements in the United States military industrial complex. And we're on their coattails doing the propaganda while they try and arm and train and fund these terrorists on the ground. That's what it looks like to me, Vanessa, just as a guy from Wolverhampton, you know, who's looked at the information that at hand and just thought, well, what the mainstream are telling us is clear bollocks, isn't it?
Well, I think, I mean, I would slightly disagree with you that Britain is on the coattails of the US. I would actually say Britain is running the intelligence operations. I always say Britain is the intelligence, America is the muscle. So America, yeah, you're right. America is supplying the hardware and the equipment. Britain is not, for example, in March this year, an SAS operative was airlifted out of the south of Syria, which has been liberated, by the way, from the armed groups by the Syrian Arab Army in Russia and is operating under the Amnesty and Reconciliation Agreement. But an SAS operative was airlifted to, I believe it was to Jordan for hospital treatment after he'd been injured in an IED explosion. Now, was he setting the IED? Certainly, I would speculate that the reason he was in southern Syria wasn't on holiday. It was to train the remainders of the armed groups that are still infesting areas like Dara, et cetera, that are on a daily basis assassinating those they consider to be loyal to the Syrian government. They are laying booby traps for military vehicles on a regular basis. So this, in my opinion, is the continuation of the clandestine war by British intelligence and by British military intelligence on the ground inside Syria. You have the Al-Tanf American military base that controls the Rukban refugee camp, which is a recruitment center for ISIS and Al-Qaeda and all of the, you know, the most extreme armed groups. It is absolute nonsense that Britain and America are there fighting ISIS. ISIS is another instrument. You know, I always say to people, look, ignore the labeling of these groups. There is no difference between them other than the funding streams and the PR. That's it. That's the only difference.
That's it. It's just mercenaries. That's it. That's all they are. It's hired fighters. You know, if we're funding them, we'll call them moderate rebels. And if Turkey are funding them, we'll call them terrorists. It's just as simple as that. That is it. They're the same people. They'll call themselves al-Nusra, al-Qaeda, and all these different names. But the fact is, they're all from this. They're all the same people. And
I remember you reminded me of Alex Thompson. We had a bit of a spat on Twitter at one point because he was saying to me, you know, regarding my testimony inside East Aleppo as civilians were coming out and destroying Western media narratives by their own testimony. And I remember his condescending little tweet to me, which was along the lines of, well, my dear, you know that they're only going to say that when they're in Syrian Arab army hands. I was like, most of them are relatives of the Syrian Arab army, you pillock. And then I've done it again. I've completely forgotten where I was going.
You're as me. You don't smoke.
I know. Sorry. My brain just gets carried away with information.
So the White, to circle back quite a little bit to the White Armies, because I want to talk about this wonderful organization a little bit. How closely hand in hand were they working with al-Nusra and al-Qaeda? Because I've seen a video by Carla Ortiz, who goes into Aleppo, and I think it's Ghouta she goes into. And the White Helmets building, with all the White Helmets posters, and there's even White Helmets jackets on the floor, etc., is right next door to the al-Nusra headquarters. And she says, she reports, that when she went in and said to the people at the White Helmets, here to save you, they've gone, who? And she's, them with the jackets, said, oh, no, they're with the terrorists, the locals are telling her. Is that what you've seen?
Yeah, I mean, I actually entered all of those headquarters. I was probably the first, alongside Pierre Lecourf, who's a French humanitarian that was based in Aleppo for the longevity of the war almost. I think he came in around 2014-15. And certainly in every single area that I visited, which included Dara, where I actually interviewed still operating White Helmets, we sort of stumbled on them actually, because it was still during the Amnesty and Reconciliation, and it was kind of one of those surreal moments where we were in Al-Nusra Front Center, we turned and our guide, who was a former armed group member carrying a Kalashnikov and driving a really flash pickup truck, and who'd been involved in the massacre that I was actually investigating of Syrian Arab Army soldiers. So the whole thing was kind of very, very weird, okay. Right? I think the only thing that actually protected me was the fact I was British. So they assumed I was on their side. So actually they were very happy to take me to where they had effectively killed and decapitated and tortured all of these Syrian Army soldiers, and then brought them back to an area close to where the White Helmets were operating. And then according to civilian testimony, the White Helmets were enabling and helping with the dismembering of the bodies of these soldiers and putting them in plastic bags and throwing them on rubbish heaps. So by chance, we entered the actual White Helmet Center where White Helmets were still operating under the, at that point, the Russian managed Amnesty and Reconciliation. And not only that, but I'd met at that point, one of the leading armed group member leaders turned up, who'd been working previously with Al-Qaeda. He was in the engineering corps, so he was producing all of the 500-ton missiles that were being fired into civilian and army areas during the conflict, Atam Al-Qarad. He turned up immediately as soon as I entered the White Helmet Center. So there was a clear, he turned up as a protectionist. In other words, who are you? What are you doing here? Yeah. So he was clearly in charge of this group of White Helmets, right? As I said, the only thing that kind of saved me was the fact that they assumed, because I'm British, they started talking to me, well, we haven't been paid for 6 months.
It gets
I mean, they literally said that to me. They said, can you talk to your government and like get the funding turned back on?
Quite profitable and, to be a White Helmet, isn't it? Pays quite well, I guess.
Well, yeah. You know, so it was a sort of, it, you know, and this is what kind of makes me laugh, is when the BBC says, but you haven't talked to any of the White Helmets. You haven't made any effort to communicate with them. Well, yeah, I have. I've spoken to former White Helmets.
And they're telling you this from their desk in London.
Yeah, exactly. I've probably got about 5 minutes left on my computer just to warn you. Because it's
okay.
Just put right. Its green light on.
I'll be as quick as possible. What do you think? This Radio 4 programme that's coming up that they're going to do, is there any way they're going to paint you in a good light here, Vanessa?
No. Absolutely not.
It's going to be another smear attempt. It's getting quite old now, isn't it?
Well, I mean, I think the only, development from the BBC is they've actually issued a veiled legal threat. They've actually said, because I have my opinion is that the White Helmets are a legitimate target in a war zone, because they're embedded with Al-Qaeda, because they carry arms, because they provide surveillance for Al-Qaeda, because they've been involved in the war crimes that Al-Qaeda have committed. My opinion is I consider them to be a legitimate target. Now, what the BBC have said is they've spoken to a humanitarian lawyer who has said that on the basis that I meet with Syrian ministers and I have, in their view, incited the bombing of the White Helmets. And of course, I have so much influence over Syrian and Russian military that they will do my bidding immediately in one of the biggest sort of global war theatres since World War II. Then I'm potentially liable. Now, my view on this and the view of a number of people is that the Julian Assange trial, which is effectively torture, incarceration, kangaroo court trial in the UK.
I've been saying it for 3 years,
is effectively emboldening the media outlets, and particularly those that are effectively extensions of state power, like the BBC is, to issue threats to dissident journalists that are exposing the BBC lying by omission, censorship, and systematic support of UK Foreign Office policy in, for example, Syria and previously in Libya and Iraq, et cetera, it doesn't matter where. Right, that's what the BBC does. It supports UK neo-colonialist war efforts wherever it is, right? And so I think what we're seeing, and along with the Overseas Act, which has now given the right to British soldiers to commit war crimes, the Secret Service Act, which is now allowing MI5 to commit crimes. If the BBC designates someone as a bad guy, they can basically go and take him out, or they can do whatever they need to do in their view to get information. They can torture him, etc. So we're entering an age of lawlessness under the cover of COVID-19. I know we haven't really touched on that, but you know, the power grab that is going on right now is affecting all of us, and particularly it's affecting media, which is exposing the power grab, which is exposing the hybrid war that has been waged against foreign nations for decades and is now, in my opinion, being waged against our own populations. Yeah. Right. And so I think we're at a kind of a tipping point where I think we as independents have to start fighting back as a unit, you know. We're all a little bit maverick, we're all a little bit independent, we're all a little bit, you know, we have to be to do what we do. We're not paid for it. We do it because we believe in it.
You're kidding me?
No. You know, we do it because we believe in it.
I
think now it's time for us to stand in solidarity with each other, even if we disagree with each other on some points, even if we have differences of opinion. It's time now to push back against the media machine, which is going to try and crush us. That's my opinion.
I fully believe this, Vanessa. I've been telling everybody for the last 3 years. I made myself ill telling people this. Julian Assange, he's the person. We stand arm in arm with him. He's where we draw the line, because if we free him, if you want to know the truth about anything, that's what we need. You want to know the truth about Prince Andrew, Jeffrey Epstein, any of this, truth about Trump, truth about Biden. Imagine if WikiLeaks would have dropped those Biden emails. Nobody would be questioning the veracity of them then, would they? They couldn't. Why? Because they've got a 100% record. This is who we need to stand arm in arm with. It's people, it's Julian Assange, it's WikiLeaks. And I'll be standing there right with you, Vanessa, because I think you're awesome. And I think it's just a shame that James Le Mesurier fell out of a window, because we get all the information. And it was just a total coincidence that happened, didn't it?
Yeah. And a total coincidence that a BBC journalist, Mark Urban, immediately tweeted out that it was a state hit and it must be Russia, and then deleted the tweet.
Mark Urban, who met Sergei Skripal not long ago.
Yeah.
Remember that? You'll have to come on and talk to me some more, Vanessa, when you've got more time.
Yeah, no problem. When I've got more time and electricity, thank you, sanctions.
Please let me know. You've got to come on again soon.
I will.
Thanks
love
so
to.
Much for all you do. You're awesome.
All right.